Bom dia a todos, um prazer enorme estar aqui com vocês novamente. E hoje a gente vai ter um seminário muito especial, direto da Suécia, né? Com o professor João Duarte, que a professora Andresa Debem vai apresentar daqui a pouco para vocês, né? Eu queria dizer que eu fiz algumas atividades no Moodle, como checar, por exemplo, quem mandou a ficha de inscrição e quem mandou a ficha de acompanhamento do nosso último seminário do Arturo. Detectei que algumas pessoas não o fizeram e mandei um e-mail pessoal para cada uma dessas pessoas, solicitando que fizessem no máximo, pelo menos, a ficha de inscrição até sexta-feira. Tá bom? Então, por favor, façam isso porque a gente precisa controlar um pouco quantos são os alunos de fato matriculados na disciplina. Bom, então eu vou passar imediatamente para a professora Andresa, quem eu já agradeço, né, a gentileza de convidar os colaboradores dela na Suécia, que vai apresentar o professor João Duarte, que também agradeço enormemente se dispor a dar essa aula super interessante sobre o que que tem na cabeça e no cérebro daquelas pessoas que são resistentes à insulina, não é isso? Então, professora Andresa, a palavra está com a senhora.
Obrigada pelo senhor, a ideia. Gente, que bom estar aqui. Eu estou longe, mas estou super perto, né? Como vocês todos sabem, e disponível aí no que precisar. Então, hoje a gente vai ter, assim, o privilégio de ouvir um pouco um colega e colaborador, que é o João Miguel Duarte. O João é português, mas ele está na Suécia desde 2017. É um jovem cientista com uma carreira muito brilhante, muito expoente. Vocês vão ver hoje na apresentação dele, mas os números, a qualidade das publicações e os trabalhos que ele vem desenvolvendo são muito relevantes, então é uma inspiração para a gente e para os alunos que estão todos aqui assistindo. E para vocês terem ideia, então, o João é bioquímico de formação, formado pela Universidade de Lisboa. Ele fez o seu doutorado na Universidade de Coimbra, na área de bioquímica, com especialização em bioenergética. Depois ele passou um tempo lá na Suíça, trabalhando como investigador, e agora ele é professor associado e investigador principal do Diabetes and Brain Function Laboratory na Universidade de Lund, na Suécia. E de grande importância também, para que vocês saibam, o João topou fazer um projeto conosco. Então, nós temos um projeto de cooperação internacional que foi aprovado dia 31 de janeiro desse ano, né, que é um CAPS-STINT, financiado pela CAPS no Brasil e pela STINT, que é o órgão equivalente da Suécia. E também tivemos um outro êxito na aprovação de um projeto de cooperação internacional da IBRO, né, que serve essencialmente para fomentar a mobilidade de estudantes e de pesquisadores entre os laboratórios no Brasil e na Suécia. Então, acho que é uma grande oportunidade vocês ouvirem e verem o que o João tem para falar e, quem sabe, né, passarem algum tempo aqui conosco um pouquinho, né, e talvez com o João mais tempo aqui na Suécia. Tá? Obrigada, João. O palco é seu agora, né? Acho que você pode continuar sua apresentação aqui, falar mais um pouquinho da trajetória, se quiser, e fique à vontade. No final, a gente segue com as perguntas, né? É isso, né?
Ok, muito obrigado pela apresentação. Eu estou realmente contente pelo convite para apresentar aqui no vosso programa. E como a professora Andresa estava a mencionar, nós tivemos dois projetos aprovados para colaborar entre o Brasil e a Suécia, e acho que isso vai ser muito frutuoso, vai ser fantástico. Eu vou então partilhar a minha apresentação. Acho que está bem, não está? E a partir de agora, como a professora estava a dizer no início, eu fiz um pós-doc bastante longo na Suíça. Acabei por ficar 9 anos na Suíça antes de vir aqui para a Suécia, e portanto já há muito tempo que não trabalho em português. Então é muito difícil falar do meu trabalho em português, e vou fazer a apresentação toda em inglês. No final, se quiserem fazer as perguntas em português, estão à vontade, que eu sei. Então, here comes the switch. So, What I'll present today is I thought of presenting this because it's somehow a way of teaching you some biochemistry, basic biochemistry of the cell and the role of neurons and astrocytes in the brain and their interaction. And that's within the work that we do in our lab, that is understanding how diabetes impacts brain function. So this is our lab, and if you ever think of coming to our lab to do some experiments, you can just contact me. We are always looking for people to join our team. This is Alba Garcia, is a postdoc here in the lab. She has done part of the experiments that I'll show today, and the rest is work that we have carried out before when I was still in Switzerland. So first, I'll introduce what is dementia. So dementia is the decline in the mental ability that is severe enough that impacts our daily life. And there's about 50 million of people worldwide that live with dementia, and this number is increasing all the time. Also because we live longer. So it's something that we have to consider to when we think about longevity, we have to age well so that we don't have disorders that affect our daily life. So it's recognized a public health priority by the World Health Organization. And up to now, there's no cure, although there are some treatments that can alleviate some symptoms. It has for a long time been accepted that type 2 diabetes is associated with Alzheimer's disease-like pathology and impaired cognition. Presently, I think most of the people are shifting this concept. It's not diabetes is not associated with Alzheimer's disease, but it's of course associated with some kind of brain dysfunction. And that's what we try to understand as well. I show here an example of a study from 2013 from the Netherlands, where they took type 2 diabetes patients and investigated their cognition or their cognitive abilities. And there are four plots of different cognitive tests, and in all of them, it was seen that there's a cognitive impairment in type 2 diabetes patients, and they followed up the patients over 12 years. And they see that there's an increased or reduced ability furthermore compared to the healthy volunteers in this study. There are many other studies like these, but in our lab, we mostly work with the animal models. And I have here two examples of animal models that we use in our lab. That is the Goto Kakizaki rat. That is a rat that spontaneously develops insulin resistance, but it's not obese. This is a spontaneous alternation measured in a Y maze, and that represents the ability of the animals to find a novel arm. So if they remember the arm that they just visited before, then they will explore the new arm. If not, the alternation between the arms is about 50%, so it's just, and that's what you see here, about 50%. Another mouse model that we use widely in the lab is the mice that are fed a high-fat diet, and that can have different percentages of fat. It can also be a combination of fat and sugar. And in all of those mice, we have seen that there's a reduced spontaneous alternation as well in the Y maze, so showing that there's spatial memory impairment. So now the question is, how does diabetes induce brain dysfunction and leads to dementia? Most of the work we are doing is trying to explore the role of insulin. We think that it's insulin signaling in the brain, among other things, but we focus on insulin, that is involved in the development of this brain dysfunction. The work that I'll show today is mostly on brain metabolism and function that depends on the cortex and hippocampus, which are areas regulating cognition. But we also work on the hypothalamus to try to understand how metabolic regulation in the whole body is affected by diabetes, by insulin resistance. So what does insulin do in the brain? Or in the brain that is relevant for cognition? most of the work that has been done in the beginning when people started to explore this was to try to understand how insulin regulates gene expression that leads to memory consolidation. It was found that it's mainly the signaling through the MAP kinase pathway that is impaired in insulin resistance and is involved in memory consolidation. However, we know also that insulin is able to indirectly control the AMP kinase pathway, which is the main intracellular metabolic sensor. So it senses whether ATP, ADP levels are modified and reacts accordingly so that you can get homeostasis. And that does lead to the control of cellular fueling. So if a cell detects that is low on ATP, then wants to increase glucose consumption. The brain mainly uses glucose so that it can fuel its activity. However, the brain is not only the neurons that do the signaling and that is important for memory and other brain functions. So we try to understand what else controls these neuronal functions that could be dependent on insulin. And we think that it's the regulation of the interaction between neurons and astrocytes. I have a picture here of astrocytes that are stained with GFAP. That's in green, and in red you can see blood vessels. And you can directly see that the astrocytes surround blood vessels. And the key function of the astrocyte is that on one side it surrounds the synapse, so it senses what the synapses of the neurons are doing. And on the other side it connects the blood vessel, and it mediates the fueling of the synapse by deciding how much glucose is needed to enter into the brain. But the astrocyte itself doesn't give the glucose directly to the neuron. So it actually oxidizes this glucose, and it's believed that it's the lactate, a product of glucose oxidation, that is shuttled back to the neuron and used to produce energy at the synaptic level. Of course, there are other functions of the astrocyte, but this is something that we are trying to explore now in this presentation. So I'll start with showing a study that we did in the Goto Kakizaki rat. You remember that it's an insulin-resistant model that is not obese. We use that because obesity itself causes inflammation in the brain, and we want to avoid that component of type 2 diabetes and focus on the insulin resistance. So we took these mice, and this is their phenotype after an overnight fasting. You can see that they're fasting glycemia is higher than in the control animals. So the controls are Wister rats. The Goto Kakizaki rat was selectively bred from Wister rats. On the other hand, there's also an increased basal insulin. Here, there's a slight shift towards increase of insulin after overnight fasting. We also did a glucose tolerance test so that we gave a bolus of 2 grams per kilo of glucose. And you can see that the controls clear fast the glucose from circulation, while the diabetic animals take quite some time to clear the glucose. And that you can see the area under the curve just below this graph. Another experiment that we did to characterize the animals was to do an hyperglycemic clamp. So glucose was maintained at about 20 millimolar in circulation by infusing a glucose solution. And you can see here that to maintain glucose at those 20 millimolar, we needed to infuse less glucose in the Goto Kakizaki rats, so that here in the black dots, than in the Wister rats. That means that there's somehow, just like here, reduced glucose uptake from circulation, so the animals have trouble in taking up glucose. At the same time of this experiment, we measured plasma insulin in circulation, and you can see here, so what you see here in this bar graph is the starting value of insulin. So I think these are fed animals. So this is insulin in the fed state of the Wister rats, and it's higher in the Goto Kakizaki rat. But when we start infusing the glucose, you can see that there's a slower release of insulin from the pancreas into circulation. And you have here lower levels of insulin for a while, but then afterwards it starts to shoot up. So the animals are actually able to produce insulin at a slower rate, but they accumulate in circulation, but that insulin is not efficient in taking up glucose, and therefore you have a need of infusing less glucose over there. So indeed, this is a nice model of insulin resistance for us to study the, those mechanisms. Another experiment that we have done in these mice was in collaboration with Rodrigo Cunha in the University of Coimbra, who was my PhD supervisor. He did some, his lab did some long-term potentiation experiments, and this is an experiment in which you take slices of the hippocampus, which is a region that is key in learning and memory, and you apply a high frequency stimulus, so it's a train of pulses at high frequency, and that increases this field potential. So you see that there's an increase in the field potentials here, but that doesn't happen to such a great extent in the Gotokakis-Aki rat. And this is actually an electrophysiological paradigm of memory. So this means, or according to the electrophysiologists, this means that there's impaired hippocampal dependent memory, which we had seen in the Y-maze task, that in the behavior task that we had done before. So this is the same graph that, that I showed you before, that has reduced spontaneous alternation in the Gotokakis-Aki rats. So these animals that are insulin resistant, their glycemia is not huge, so we are not studying chronic hyperglycemia, and they are not obese, so we don't have the obesity component. We think we are really studying insulin resistance here. So what did we use these animals for? So we did an experiment, so the title of the talk was Metabolic Profiling with Magnetic Resonance Spectroscopy. So we did an experiment, a magnetic resonance spectroscopy experiment, in which we gave glucose that is labeled with carbon 13 into of its atoms. So we infuse this glucose in the rats while the rats are in inside a magnet, and we collect the signal that we obtain from the brain of the animals. And now you ask, what's the signal? This was actually work done by Sarah Sonai while she was doing the PhD with me and Freya Giro, and we published this a couple of years ago. So what we see, what we detect in the brain is a sequential spectra like this. So every line that you see here is one spectrum. So you see at the bottom the spectrum within the, so each spectrum is acquired for 5 minutes. So this is the first 5 minutes after infusion of glucose, and the infusion continues over 4 hours. So what you see here is the first minute, and you immediately see here on your left that there's a peak appearing immediately. That's the peak of glucose C6, the carbon 6 of glucose, that shows up in the brain, and this is measured from the whole brain. And immediately at the same time, you start seeing that there's a peak of glutamate C4 that appears in the brain. Now I'll explain you in a while how that label appears in glutamate. So after a while, the labeling starts to go from these carbons of glutamate and glucose into other carbons of glutamate, also carbons of glutamine and of aspartate. And with this method that we use, we are able to measure all the aliphatic carbons of glutamate. Aliphatic carbons are those that are bound to protons. So what do we do with this? With the data from this spectra. So we quantify the spectra by line fitting, and we get the area of these peaks. What you see here is the analysis of the peaks of glucose, and we can use that if we know how much glucose was in circulation. We can use that to estimate glucose transport into the brain, just like a PET experiment will do. One of these FDG PET experiments that are used for Alzheimer's disease research, for example. So what we have here in the top graph is the data from a Wister rat, and in the bottom of the Gotokakis-Aki. And you see in the gray symbols the plasma glucose that raises because we started an infusion and we try to keep it constant. And in the open symbols, you see glucose, labeled glucose in the brain. And you, the line is the fitting of a model of glucose transport. So you can see that as soon as we increase glucose levels in the brain, in circulation, glucose levels in the brain start to increase as well. And they will equilibrate because glucose transport across cells is concentrated. So that's what we measure here. And our model then estimated that there was a small reduction in the maximum transport rate of glucose across the blood-brain barrier in the Gotokakizaki rats versus the control. And the same for total glucose consumption in the brain. So once the glucose is in the brain, it's oxidized. And there was also a small reduction in glucose consumption. This was a surprise to us. We expected a larger reduction because that's what has been pointed out by other neurodegeneration models, including in Alzheimer's disease models. But we didn't see that. We saw a very small reduction in glucose utilization in the brain. So this CMR glucose stands for cerebral metabolic rate of glucose. So glucose got into the brain, and then it's oxidized in the glycolysis. That's what you have here. And our labeling in glucose will appear in pyruvate after the glycolysis. And pyruvate dehydrogenase oxidizes that to acetyl-CoA. So it activates pyruvate to acetyl-CoA. So it is oxidized in mitochondria. Once it's in mitochondria, this is a complex scheme, but what I want is that you take the general information from here. Don't focus on the details. This is the mitochondrial metabolism, the tricarboxylic acid cycle. I'm sure you remember that from your basic biochemistry. So the acetyl-CoA labeling is oxidized in the cycle, incorporated in 2-oxoglutarate. The position C4, and then in oxaloacetate. Since there are some symmetric molecules in the TCA cycle, the labeling will be split into other carbons of oxaloacetate. So I point these two here because this exchange with glutamate and with aspartate, and that was labeling that we saw in vivo in the brain of the rats. And that was the first peak that we saw, glutamate C4, and then we also saw aspartate labeling in the aliphatic carbons, that's the carbon 2 and 3. Of course, the label can exit the TCA cycle, but it can also persist in the cycle and appear in other carbons of glutamate and also in the other carbons of aspartate. Now, the brain has something very interesting, that is, the astrocytes, or the glial cells, are the only cells in the brain that have pyruvate carboxylase. And what pyruvate carboxylase does is to add CO2 to pyruvate. Pyruvate is a 3-carbon molecule, and by adding CO2, you produce oxaloacetate. And because we gave a specific pattern of labeling in glucose, that's the carbons 1 and 6, we only get labeling in pyruvate in the carbon 3, and that label will be taken only to the oxaloacetate C3, not the C2. And because of this difference, the labeling persists in the cycle and will label different carbons of glutamate. Because of the difference between the labeling of these 3 carbons, we are able to distinguish the metabolic rates in the neurons and also in the astrocytes. And we do that by designing a mathematical model that describes metabolism in the neurons, where you don't have pyruvate carboxylase, only pyruvate dehydrogenase, and in the astrocytes, where you have both pyruvate dehydrogenase and pyruvate carboxylase. And while the astrocytes and the neurons can exchange many molecules and many metabolites, the glutamatergic neurotransmission, that's the one that uses glutamate to pass the signal to the next neurons, is a very important connection between the neurons and the astrocytes, because the neurons release glutamate to the synapse, but they take back very little of that glutamate. So most of the glutamate that came into the synapse is actually taken by the astrocyte, which in turn signals into the cell, into the intracellular compartment of the astrocyte, and produces a lot of metabolic alterations that then signal back the neuron. And once it enters into the astrocyte, this glutamate is converted to glutamine that is given back to the neuron. So the neurons, when they take glutamate, they don't actually produce glutamine. They don't have glutamine synthetase. So what they do is that directly they incorporate this glutamate into vesicles to be shut out again. So this cycle of glutamate-glutamine cycle between neurons and astrocytes is key in maintaining glutamate homeostasis and glutamatergic neurotransmission, which is very important for memory as well. So this is our model. We fit this mathematical model to our data, and that's what you see here. So in white, you see, so first you see each graph is a graph for one aliphatic carbon that we measured in glutamate, glutamine, and in aspartate at the bottom. The white symbols are Wister rats, and the red symbols are the Gotokakizaki rats, and our model fits relatively well to the data. And you can see here, for example, in glutamine, we can already see quite some differences in the labeling of between Gotokakizaki rats and Wister rats. So the fitting of our model turns out to be reflected in a number of metabolic fluxes from the brain. What you have here is what I showed you before, so the transport of glucose across the blood-brain barrier that is reduced in the Gotokakizaki rat, and also a small reduction in glucose utilization. And what we see as well is that there's a small about half reduction of the release of glutamate from the neurons. So there's we call that glutamatergic neurotransmission, as well as the rate of glutamine synthesis in the astrocytes that is then shuttled to the neurons. Moreover, we see that there's a small reduction in the neuronal TCA cycle. So neurons in the Gotokakizaki rats still are able to produce a lot of energy in mitochondria, but there's a small reduction, and we are not sure if this is significant or not for our model. On the other hand, to our surprise, we saw that there was an increased rate of mitochondrial metabolism in the astrocytes, in the glial cells. And that was substantial. So that was larger than the reduction we saw in the mitochondrial metabolism in the neurons. I think, not yet. I'll explain in a while why we think there's these differences in metabolism. Another thing that we decided to do, so it's very well known that glycogen is required for glutamatergic neurotransmission to be efficient. Some people have shown that if you actually block glycogenolysis, and glycogen only exists in the astrocyte, then you impair memory. That means that the glycogen has to be hydrolyzed, converted to something that is shuttled to the neurons to be used for efficient memory formation. And so we decided to investigate that in our model. So like I was saying, glutamatergic neurotransmission is necessary to support neuronal function. Memory formation requires also a glycogen breakdown, and it was also shown in a nice paper that insulin and the insulin growth factor type 1 are able to regulate glycogen metabolism in the astrocytes. Still not sure if this happens in vivo, but at least in astrocytes, glycogen metabolism is regulated by insulin. So we took again our rats, and this was work done by a postdoc that was working with me, Ana Francisca Soares, and a master student, Sakura Nussbaum. I was forgetting her name, sorry. So we do the same experiment. We do a magnetic resonance spectroscopy experiment in which we give glucose, but this time glucose is labeled in only one carbon, and we follow the labeling to glycogen. So this is what we see here. We see two peaks of glucose because glucose exists in two enomers, so the alpha and the beta, that are actually the same molecule but with different conformations. That's why we see two peaks in the NMR. And we see, so there's an immediate appearance of glucose in the brain like before, and we see incorporation into glycogen. So the glucose is taken by the brain and incorporated into glycogen. You may remember when I told you about the last experiment that we had spectra that was acquired over 5 minutes. So every 5 minutes we have one data point. The spectra that you see here is acquired for about 1 hour. So every hour we have one data point on glycogen metabolism. And that's because the glycogen metabolism in the brain is very slow. Or at least, maybe we can discuss that at the end. Maybe glycogen metabolism is not slow per se, but the glycogen metabolism that we can measure with this method and that represents the turnover of the molecule is relatively slow. So these experiments are carried out for about 10 hours where you have the animal inside the scanner and we accumulate a spectra for 1 hour and measure this glycogen synthesis rate. Indeed, what we saw in labeling incorporation to glycogen was that it was about half what you see in the Wister controls. And in this case, these are only two examples, also two typical animals. And our first thought was that maybe glycogen levels are much smaller in the brain, and therefore you could have the same synthesis rate, but since you have less amount of glycogen, then you label less glycogen. However, we measure total glycogen levels in extracts from the brain, and they are actually identical. So this really reflects a synthesis rate reduction in Goto Kakizaki rats. And that's what you have here. So this is the fit of an exponential curve that then can give you the rate of glycogen synthesis. And it's about it's much smaller in the Goto Kakizaki rat to about half of the rate, which, if you remember from the previous experiment, was also about half of the rate of glutamatergic neurotransmission. So there's a very good match between the rate of glycogen hydrolysis and the rate of glutamatergic neurotransmission in our experiments. So afterwards, we wanted to understand which brain areas are mostly affected in the Goto Kakizaki rat. And we have looked into the hippocampus, that is here, the cortex, as well as the striatum and the hypothalamus. I can say that there were modifications in the hypothalamus as well, but here it's mostly relevant for this presentation is the hippocampus and the cortex. And we can see that what you see here is the labeling rate, and that was already, the amount of glucose that is labeled was smaller in the Goto Kakizaki rat, that is in gray. So this is in the brain and mimics what you see in the plasma. And here, this is how much label got into glycogen. So there's almost the same in the cortex, the same difference in the cortex, but not in the hippocampus. So there's much less labeling, or there's a little bit less labeling in the glycogen of the hippocampus compared to the glucose in the Goto Kakizaki compared to the Wister rat here. And this means that the hippocampus that is relevant for memory performance is affected more than the cortex in this particular. Alba in our lab also looked at the enzymes that synthesize glycogen. She looked at the glycogen phosphorylase. So the brain has two enzymes, two isoforms of glycogen phosphorylase. None of them was modified in the hippocampus or the cortex of Goto Kakizaki rats. Then we also look at glycogen synthase that is responsible for making glycogen, and the levels of the enzyme were reduced in the hippocampus but not in the cortex. But this enzyme is immediately regulated, or there's a very fast regulation mechanism that is by phosphorylation. And when you phosphorylate glycogen synthase, you reduce its activity. And indeed, you see that in both the hippocampus and the cortex, there's a reduction, an increase in the phosphorylation rate. And this is the ratio between phosphorylated and total glycogen synthase, showing that there's indeed increased phosphorylation of the enzyme in both the hippocampus and cortex. likely representing a reduction in activity of the enzyme. We have a quite big project in collaboration with Gianni Baroni in Sapienza University in Rome, where we try to understand how insulin signaling controls metabolism in the brain of the Gotokakizaki rats. So in terms of pathways that lead to these metabolic modifications that we see. I'm just pointing one here that fits very well with the data that we have. That is the insulin signals through the AKT pathway and inhibits the GSK3 beta that in turn inhibits glycogen synthase. What Eugenio saw was that there was an increase in the total levels of GSK3 beta in the Gotokakizaki rat, a reduction in the phosphorylation of the serine 9 site of the GSK3 beta, that is the site that is phosphorylated by AKT, which inhibits it. So if you have a reduction, then you have an increase of activity. And on the other hand, there was an increased phosphorylation of this tyrosine site, which then results in activation. So there's what we see is that there's increase in GSK3 beta activity in the brain of, this is the hippocampus, in the hippocampus of the Gotokakizaki rat, which in turn results in higher inhibition of glycogen synthase activity. We also have details on other pathways, but this is what is mostly interesting for this particular presentation. So to summarize these experiments, we had seen that the insulin resistance in the Gotokakizaki rats results in reduced transport of glucose, reduced utilization of glucose, and reduced metabolism of glycogen that is only present in the astrocytes and is necessary to memory formation and to synaptic activity in the neurons. We had also seen that there was a small reduction in mitochondrial metabolism of the neurons. And on the other hand, there was an exacerbation of mitochondrial metabolism in the astrocytes. Finally, we saw that there was a small about half reduction in the rate of glutamate-glutamine cycle, by which the neurons release glutamate to synapse that is taken by astrocytes, converted to glutamine, and shuttled back to the neurons. So these were the modifications that we saw here. And then the question was, why do we see a reduction in metabolism in the astrocytes, and why do we see an increase reduction of metabolism in the neurons and increase of metabolism in the astrocytes? We look into proteins that are specific to different compartments of the neuron and astrocyte, and we had seen indeed that two proteins that are only located in the astrocyte had increased levels. So these are cytoskeleton proteins, that's the GFAP and vimentin. Since both are increasing, this somehow suggests that there's increased volume of astrocytes in the hippocampus of Gotokakizaki rats. And on the other hand, there was a reduction in proteins that are located in the synapses of the neurons, but not in proteins that are, so this is on the presynaptic side of the synapse, not in the postsynaptic side or in a tubular protein that will be in all the neuronal compartment. And what we think is that, and this was supported by other experiments as well in other models, is that type 2 diabetes does not cause neuronal death, and that's why the volume of neurons is not modified, but it impairs synaptic function, as we see by reduced synaptic protein levels. And it turns out to increase levels of astrocytic proteins that is in line with astrogliosis in the brain. okay, so then we wanted So the experience that I just showed you with this magnetic resonance spectroscopy using carbon are very cumbersome. So it's very difficult to carry out these experiments. It takes a lot of time to analyze the data, and they are not direct. They don't give us direct information. So we have to do a lot of mathematical modeling to extract metabolic rates. So another experiment that we do is to measure proton spectroscopy, which is a method that gives us the peaks that correspond to the concentration of protons in the brain. And this allows us to measure about 18 to 20 metabolites in the brain of a rat or a mouse. So what you have here is a spectra from the Wistar and the Gotokakizaki rat taken from the hippocampus. We also have data from other brain regions, but let's focus here. And what we had seen was that there are some metabolic modifications. So this is a metabolic profile. Doesn't give us the information about the metabolic rates, but it can tell us something about which pathways can be affected in brain metabolism. So we see some metabolic modifications, but the most strikingly, and we have repeated this in different cohorts of animals, was that there's an increase in the concentration of taurine. This was a very robust increase in the peaks of taurine. So just by looking at the spectrum that comes directly from the magnet, we could tell which animal had been scanned. So this was a very clear change in the brain of the Gotokakizaki rat. And now we have been dedicating quite some time to try to understand why this is. So the first thing we have done was an experiment to try to understand whether these terms in taurine are modifiable with the diet. So what we did was to take mice that we exposed to a diet that is rich in fat and sucrose. So we give a 60% fat diet. And we also give, together with the water, we give a bottle of water and a bottle of 20% sucrose and allow them to drink freely. And they actually like the sucrose much better than the water. And what we tried to mimic here was, let's say, Western diet. When you go to a fast food chain and just take your fatty burger and you take a Coke. So this is what we're trying to mimic in this animal model. So we established this model and tried to understand what happens over time. So we have measured this proton magnetic resonance spectroscopy before and at different points after exposing to the diet. We also have looked at other things in the animals. And for example, we know now that within 1 week, we already start to see signs of brain insulin resistance. So this is in the hippocampus of the animals. You can already see that that pathway I showed you before of the that is operated by insulin through AKT and GSK3 beta, the signaling is already slightly reduced in the hippocampus of the high fat, high sucrose diet mice compared to the controls. So the controls just take low fat and without sugar. We also looked at the MAP kinase that you remember in the beginning, I told you that's the main pathway that modulates gene expression related to memory, and we didn't see a change in that. And we also didn't see a change in the phosphorylation of the insulin receptor, which somehow indicates that insulin is still operating, and these animals have actually already at 1 week, they are insulin so a little bit insulin resistant, even though they don't have higher insulin levels. But we can see that in the hippocampus, phosphorylation of the receptor is still good. But then the downstream pathway is probably not operating so well. We also know that at this time point, we didn't see astrogliosis yet, but we do see that later at 1 month of exposure to the diet. So we have here immunohistochemistry in the hippocampus of a low-fat fed mouse, and you can see staining for this GFAP that labels the astrocytes. And on the right side, you have a mouse that is exposed to high fat, high sucrose diet. And you can see that the astrocytes are already bigger, so that the compartment of the astrocyte is getting enlarged. And maybe at the end, we can discuss the consequences of that if you are not familiar with what astrogliosis is. So we can see that there are some modifications happening, and then we conducted this spectroscopy that I was telling you. We did that in the cortex and also in the hippocampus. We did not see modifications in the cortex. We are still conducting these experiments, so we don't know yet. We don't have all the data yet. But we see modifications in the hippocampus. Most strikingly, those modifications are in the levels of glutamate, which I actually didn't plot here, and the levels of taurine. And what we see, as you can see here, taurine levels in the controls are this this black line over here. In red, you have the mice fed a high-fat, high-sucrose diet, and you can see that after 2 months of exposure to that diet, they show already high levels of taurine in the hippocampus. Sorry. That persists over until the 6 months of exposure to the diet. But there was this group here that, as you can see here in the scheme, we exposed to the diet for 4 months. So they are fed for 4 months with high-fat, high-sucrose diet. And then we reverse that diet to the control diet, so to the low-fat. And we can see that not only the metabolic phenotype recovers, so they normalize their metabolic performance, but you also see that taurine levels in the brain decrease again to the control levels. So this was very interesting, which gave us a little bit more strength to our idea of studying the role of taurine in the brain. and I think I know there's still one slide before going to the end, to the last slide. That is that these mice, indeed, just to show that they have memory impairment, you can see this is an object location recognition task where we train animals for 5 minutes to identify two objects. So they are allowed to freely explore two objects in a squared maze. And 1 hour later, we move one of the objects to another quadrant. So this object B was moved somewhere else in the maze. And then if they remember the previous location of the objects, they will explore more the new location compared to the object that was not moved. And indeed, in the control animals, we see that they prefer the new object that was relocated that is not present in the high-fat, high-sucrose diet-fed animals, but that also recovers to a certain level in the animals in which the diet was reversed. So we are being able to reverse the phenotype. We have studied more of these animals, and now there are many things we have looked at, and not everything recovers, but there's some degree of recovery in brain function as well in these animals. You have two sets of data here. One is because this is male mice, and on the other side, on the right side, this is female mice. And you can see that the similar pattern in brain function is. So to conclude, we have seen that there's impaired memory performance in insulin resistance in our animal models, which is accompanied by metabolism alterations in the neurons and in the astrocytes. And I have shown you before what that is. There's a reduced metabolism in the neurons that is associated, or we think it's associated, to damage of the synapses. And on the other hand, there's exacerbation of metabolism in the astrocytes that is probably related to the need of energy for astrogliosis, so that they become hyperreactive and may damage the neurons because of that. We have investigated hippocampal metabolic profile changes, and we have seen that taurine is a key change in metabolism in the brain, and we have been trying to understand the role of taurine. Taurine is an amino acid, or it's not, it's a sulfur amino acid that plays a role as an osmolyte. So it keeps the water levels intracellularly. It also acts as a GABAergic modulator, so it can modulate inhibitory neurotransmission. So it has a number of functions, and one that we think it's important for our studies is that it modulates mitochondrial function as well. So it's a key regulator of mitochondrial function. So we are trying to understand how taurine modulates mitochondrial function, because that could be the key to understand our metabolic modifications. Just to tell you that we have seen these taurine modifications in other models of diabetes, in streptozotocin-treated rats. We have published that a few years ago. And we have seen now in the Goto-Kakizaki rats and in the high-fat fed mice, as well as these high-fat isocruz fed mice that is recovered. So the next step, we are exposing mice to taurine and see what are going to be the effects of this treatment. I think that's what I had to tell you today. I hope you learned something, and I'm open to any questions that you may have.
Obrigada, João, por a brilhante apresentação. Surgiram várias perguntas na minha cabeça. Eu vou, se me permitirem, eu vou fazer algumas e trazer algumas do público também e estimular que os estudantes façam bastante perguntas, porque nós tivemos aqui uma super aula de bioquímica e de metabolismo junto com toda essa apresentação de resultados, João. Obrigada, viu?
Antes de começar com as perguntas, só queria dizer que eu estou de férias, não estou a trabalhar e, portanto, tenho a tarde toda agora, tenho o tempo todo para as perguntas. Não se inibam.
Queria só falar, João, que a gente tem uma equipe de backup, que aliás eu queria agradecer aqui em público, que é a Simone, a Mônica, o Ricardo, que ficam monitorando o chat do YouTube, né? E no nosso chat individual, para a gente passar as perguntas para a Andresa, começou a ter uma discussão. Eu falei, gente, vamos perguntar para ele. Enfim, mas eu acho que muito interessante, né? Vamos lá.
Vamos, então eu vou primeiro colocar uma questão aí para a galera que está ouvindo, né? A taurina é do Red Bull, te dá asas, né? Então, aí o pessoal já fica pensando e eu acho, sim, que essa possibilidade de estar regulando função mitocondrial me parece que seja uma pegada bastante importante, João. Vamos deixar para o pessoal perguntar aí da taurina. Eu vou te repassar uma pergunta que as pessoas têm me feito muito e você explicou aqui e eu queria que você reforçasse. É a questão de... Você falou, resistência à insulina cerebral. Como que a gente caracteriza essa resistência à insulina no cérebro, né? Claro que você mostrou ali os dados de fosforilação da KT, você mostrou também a questão do metabolismo, você... muito mais do que nos outros trabalhos, mostra ali a entrada, a transferência de glicose para dentro do cérebro e esse metabolismo celular. Mas como que a gente consegue explicar isso facilmente, assim, principalmente para os alunos entenderem? Porque, né, em comparação com a resistência à insulina periférica, João, você consegue fazer essa síntese? Não sei se isso é uma pergunta para você também.
Essa pergunta... Vou mudar para inglês, desculpa, tenho mais facilidade. What I'm going to say is a lot of my personal opinion on the problem of brain insulin resistance. That is, we know that insulin is necessary to operate brain functions. So if you block insulin receptors, or if you have an insulin receptor knockout, then they have deficient LTP, for example. So there's a number of things that are necessary to be operated by insulin so that the brain can perform its functions. However, that is not related to the transport of glucose directly. And that's because glucose uptake from circulation is mostly driven by GLUT1, that is not an insulin-dependent carrier. So the GLUT4 is the one that senses insulin. It was shown by a group in Spain, and for a while I liked that study very much, that's Torres Aleman, that had a paper showing that insulin is necessary together with IGF-1 to maintain the levels of GLUT1 in the plasma membrane of astrocytes. And so if you have insulin resistance, that's my interpretation, that means that you will not be able to keep the GLUT1 there, so you'll have less carriers at the membrane to take glucose inside. Right? I liked that paper for a long time until I really discussed it in a journal club here in the lab, and we found so many flaws that we could not explain, and no one ever reproduced those experiments. So I'm not sure how good that is. Another thing that, so insulin resistance, just like in the periphery, would be, okay, we have insulin, it binds to the receptor, but the information is not transmitted into the cell, right? Or the transmission is not efficient. And that's maybe what we have in the brain. And in terms of metabolism, one thing that we think that is happening is that at the level of glycogen, insulin signaling will be necessary to modulate how glycogen is used to produce pyruvate or lactate to be given to neurons. And we know that if glycogen is not used, then you have memory impairment. On the other hand, there was shown a few years ago, in the synapses, you have GLUT4. So that's the insulin-sensitive carrier. And that GLUT4 is translocated to the membrane when you have increased synaptic activity. So insulin probably is involved in somehow coordinating synaptic activity and the translocation of this GLUT4 to the plasma membrane in the axon, so that you could feed the synapse with more glucose when you have energy needs. There was a last thing I wanted to say, was that there was another study showing that if you inject animals with A-beta, you impair this GLUT4 translocation in the synapse. So this somehow all is related. But again, glucose utilization in the brain per se is not dependent on insulin. So when the insulin binds to the receptor, if you have insulin resistance, it's because something else that is regulated by insulin is not happening, not the glucose, as in the periphery, because in the periphery is mostly the utilization of glucose.
Uhum. Ok, João, muito obrigada pela sua explicação. Realmente é um ponto bem, não é que é controverso, mas é realmente difícil de explicar, não é? Porque a gente sempre pensa em resistência em insulina, em atividade de transportador de glicose na periferia e transferir isso para o cérebro. E aí eu justamente falei isso para um aluno, olha, a gente não consegue medir exatamente a captação de glicose nas células neuronais, porque nós temos ali um conjunto diferente de células, e essa conversa do astrócito com o neurônio é uma questão bem legal também, que eu vou reforçar aqui agora. E isso está acontecendo de forma independente nos dois tipos celulares, né? E independente de insulina. Então, a medida da ativação de AKT é um sinal, né, de ativação ou não da resistência à insulina. E que...
Vou só complicar um bocadinho. Nós, só para dizer que se nós, por exemplo, quiséssemos medir a resistência à insulina, não basta medir a AKT, fosforilação e etc. Temos que fazer isso na presença de insulina. Portanto, teríamos que administrar insulina e medir, porque a AKT é um hub onde tudo liga, qualquer... membrane receptor vai ativar a AKT.
Uhum. Então não é muito simples não identificar ou quantificar a resistência à insulina cerebral, né? E aí, João, eu queria também reforçar, porque tem uma pergunta aqui que está controversa, mas que o pessoal quer que faça para você, mas antes eu acho que é importante a gente ressaltar essa complementariedade de funções entre o astrócito e o neurônio, e entre o astrócito e o endotélio e a periferia, não é? Né? Unidade neurovascular, eu gosto de chamar assim, porque é uma complementação de efeitos, né, de células, para suportar o metabolismo neuronal, né, que não pode parar. Então, o neurônio, ele é poupado de um monte de coisas, né, para ele conseguir fazer atividade sináptica e a transmissão sináptica efetivamente. E eu gosto de explicar assim, de uma forma mais elementar para os alunos também, que o astrócito ele quase que, né, mastiga e vomita para o neurônio comer, né? Para que o neurônio tenha menos trabalho e que seja mais eficiente. E aí, né, a gente está vendo que os astrócitos realmente parecem estar completamente desregulados nessa situação de descontrole metabólico do diabetes, né? Então, você mostrou lá a ativação de astrócito, você mostrou um comprometimento, né, do suporte de glicogênio desses astrócitos, que certamente vai comprometer a bioenergética neuronal. E aí me vem uma pergunta, inclusive é da minha ex-aluna de doutorado, da Daiane, é que ela questionou assim, tá, mas a piruvato carboxilase pode ser considerada um marcador exclusivo de astrócito? E aí a gente queria a tua opinião.
Pelo menos não está nos neurônios. Eu posso enviar, eu posso procurar uns artigos e enviar, eu uso essas referências frequentemente. Não é exclusiva dos astrócitos, mas não está nos neurónios. Por exemplo, eu acho que também pode existir em microglia, oligodendrócitos, não tenho a certeza, mas não existe nos astrócitos, assim como glicogênio. Glicogênio durante muito, muito tempo foi assumido como estar exclusivamente em astrócitos. Mas agora já se sabe que os neurónios também têm glicogênio em muito pequena quantidade, e o problema é que se o glicogênio acumula nos neurónios, eles degeneram. Portanto, os neurónios não podem acumular glicogênio, mas existe uma quantidade muito, muito pequenina, porque eles têm toda a maquinaria mesmo assim, portanto aquilo é bastante regulado. Portanto, agora, para dizer, essas coisas podem ser usadas como marcadores, até agora parece que sim, mas não se sabe se daqui a uns dias alguém não mostra que existe neurônio também a piruvato carboxilase.
Uma outra pergunta, que foi a primeira aqui, João, que fizeram, é que a resistência à insulina, né, inclusive no cérebro, leva à demência, tá? E aí a nossa aluna colocou aqui que existem alguns tratamentos farmacológicos que aumentam a sensibilidade da insulina no cérebro ou no hipocampo. E se existe isso, né? Eu acho que ela estava falando de resistência à insulina periférica, se pode modular a resistência à insulina cerebral. O que você tem a falar dessas possibilidades farmacológicas?
É verdade. Tem sido usada há vários. Tenho que mudar para inglês. There are several clinical trials in which people are using either insulin or insulin sensitizing agents that are given intranasal, and that directly enters the brain and improves cognitive function. That was only shown experimentally. People have shown that in animals, people have shown that in humans, but the clinical trials never showed any results at the end. All the results were from pilot experiments. It was the first clinical trial finishing, I think, was giving insulin, was at the end of 2018. And I'm personally not sure if I have seen already the result from that trial. I don't think it was, it came out yet. But, okay. But that's a good idea. I mean, that will be a positive impact to improve memory in insulin resistance.
A gente também vê alguns efeitos, por exemplo, da liraglutida, que é um medicamento que melhora também a função periférica e também resistência à insulina, e parece que também demonstrou em testes pré-clínicos uma...
Sim, e as incretinas também têm mostrado efeitos fantásticos, quer na diabetes, querem cognitive dysfunction em modelos.
E nesse caso, se a pessoa não é diabética, ou sei lá, enfim, você tem algum efeito controverso do uso disso em termos do metabolismo periférico? Quando você usa esse tipo de medicamento, que você tenta... Não sei se você entendeu o que eu queria dizer.
Eu acho que não sou a pessoa certa para recomendar nada, mas em princípio não, porque a administração intranasal não afeta a periferia. Em princípio não, mas obviamente que é tudo uma questão de, se calhar, de dose, não sei. Okay. Mas os estudos em que usaram insulina administrada intranasal não diminuem a glicémia, portanto não passa nada para a periferia. ou se calhar é degradada até chegar à periferia.
Estou perguntando isso porque todo mundo tem uma tia, né, que está passando por isso. Então, eu tenho uma tia que está passando por isso, eu já estou até pensando aqui o que, que eu posso fazer.
João, o professor Ricardo, que é um colega nosso aqui, né, a gente está falando bastante de metabolismo e talvez de disfunção mitocondrial, que eu acho que é uma, algo que a gente pode estudar bastante nesses modelos, né? E ele perguntou se você avaliou ou tem alguma perspectiva de avaliar o estresse do retículo endoplasmático nessa história toda.
Naquela colaboração que nós temos com o grupo em Itália, com o Eugênio Barone, nós não avaliamos o stress per se, mas avaliamos proteínas que refletem stress mitocondrial e do retículo. E o que eu vou dizer é bastante surpreendente, mas na realidade o que nós estamos a encontrar é uma redução de stress no hipocampo destes animais. E por outro lado, não sei se repararam no gráfico onde nós medíamos o perfil metabólico, nós encontramos, por exemplo, um aumento, e isto também era consistente, o aumento da ascorbato, da ácido, de vitamina C, ácido ascórbico no cérebro, que é contraintuitivo quando se pensa em dano. Nós pensaríamos, ok, há uma redução de glutationo, de ascorbato, e na realidade não, nós encontramos um aumento e nós vimos que há uma redução de stress oxidativo. Eu não me lembro exatamente de todos os detalhes das coisas que foram ditas, mas nós concluímos que havia uma redução de stress mitocondrial e do retículo, e que nós achamos que estamos a estudar uma fase transiente do sistema, em que estes animais têm um problema cerebral, têm disfunção cognitiva, têm astrogliose, têm disfunção sináptica, mas se calhar em termos metabólicos estão capazes de compensar isso. E que provavelmente mais tarde, com o acumular, porque nós medimos, estudámos os animais com 6 meses de idade, são relativamente jovens. E então o que estamos a fazer agora é a coletar amostras de animais até 24 meses de idade, para testar se há uma, como é que progride. Porque nós estamos num limbo em que parece que há uma proteção, mas, por outro lado, nós temos um dano, portanto, não sabemos bem como interpretar isso.
Ok, João.
Só para fazer uma correçãozinha, essa pergunta foi da professora Mônica Garcia, né? Não do professor Ricardo. Mas, assim, tem o nosso time aqui do backup, né? Que também tem a participação fundamental do Divago, né? E da professora Anamélia, que é inspiradora aqui desse modelo de disciplina, né? Também tem uma pergunta da Simone perguntando se é verdade que há evidências de diferenças de metabolismo entre neurônios e astrócitos, entre machos e fêmeas. E considerando que para alguns tipos de demência, o percentual de mulheres afetadas, como o caso do Alzheimer, é prevalente, você acha que tem alguma correlação entre essas dois fenômenos, ou seja, o efeito da resistência da insulina no metabolismo cerebral em homens e mulheres com essa prevalência?
Não sei. Nós, os estudos que estamos a fazer agora, estamos a fazer todos nos dois géneros, temos sempre machos e fêmeas em todos os estudos. Nós vemos que, por exemplo, quando induzimos a obesidade, ao contrário dos humanos, nos ratinhos, as fêmeas são mais resistentes ao desenvolvimento da resistência à insulina periférica. No entanto, no cérebro nós vemos efeitos semelhantes, não vemos diferenças. Mas, mais uma vez, isto são os modelos que nós temos, não sei qual seria a reflexão para o humano.
Ok. Você quer ir, Andressa?
Só para reforçar, o que nós vemos no cérebro é idêntico entre machos e fêmeas. No entanto, na periferia, nós vemos que os machos são mais afetados. Portanto, o fenótipo é mais severo nos machos, mas ao nível do cérebro é idêntico.
Ok.
O fenótipo de resistência
De
insulínica.
diabetes, e, sim.
Tem mais alguma pergunta aqui do Gabriel. Pasquarelli, que é um estudante de doutorado, ele perguntou: Do you think if dietary intervention is sufficient for improving the hippocampal dysfunction?
We have seen that there's a recovery of a spatial memory performance when we just reverse the diet to a normal diet. And we know, I mean, from the studies on bariatric surgeries, where you just reduce your obesity and you improve your metabolic phenotype immediately within a few months. So I think yes, I mean, reducing what we intake, I think has a lot of impact.
Mas talvez isso por algum tempo, não é, João? Também não sei até que ponto.
We know that these are diseases that are all related to, these are normal things, right? The cell has trouble with oxygen, right? It's all about oxygen. Oxygen is toxic. So you generate free radicals. There's a lot of problems because you have metabolism happening. And the key is to prevent that. And diet, exercise, these are easy ways where you can improve your performance. So if you exercise, I think recent studies have shown that 150 minutes per week of exercise, aerobic exercise, improves reduces your risk of mortality, cardiovascular diseases, cognitive performance, everything. And the same comes with diet. If you have a healthy diet, then you also prevent a lot of things. Of course, there's genetics. Some diseases have a genetic component and that we cannot change, but diet interventions and exercise, they improve a lot.
João, quando tu fizeste esse modelo de reversão, a resistência à insulina periférica no período de reversão, quando a ração voltou a ser ração normal, ela reverteu totalmente?
Sim.
Sim. Porque em alguns modelos isso parece ser mais persistente também com mais tempo.
Nós fizemos... querem high-fat diet, querem high-fat, high-sucrose diet, e em qualquer um deles reverte completamente, pelo menos connosco. Nós usamos C57 Black 6 mice. Uhum. Other strains may be different.
Ok. O meu aluno aqui de pós-graduação está perguntando uma questão bem bioenergética aqui. Se você acha que aumentando o gasto energético, por exemplo, aumentando o proton leak, pode ser uma alternativa para normalizar os efeitos da hiperglicemia? Por exemplo, uma atividade controladora.
Nós, no nosso caso, não temos hiperglicemia. Ou quer dizer, temos, mas não é exagerada. Não, no entanto, voltando à questão da bioquímica mitocôndrica, eu acho que não. Porque a dissipação, isso é, por exemplo, quando há um stroke, o problema mitocondrial vem de um proton leakage que ocorre e a mitocôndria começa a perder a capacidade de funcionar a partir daí. Não sei se, acho que isso não ia melhorar nada. Mas não sei. Isso é um bocado de especulação. Por exemplo, no astrócito nós vemos que há uma exacerbação do metabolismo mitocondrial. Pensar, ok, vamos criar aqui desacoplar a mitocôndria do astrócito, será que isto tem um efeito benéfico? Se calhar o astrócito precisa daquela energia para as funções que está a ter. O facto de irmos desromper, não sei se existe em português, mas dissipar o gradiente mitocondrial, se calhar isso ia ter um impacto na célula que a ia tornar... sei, mais agressiva para o neurônio, eu não faço ideia, não sei mesmo.
Até porque eu já acho que existe uma alteração nata da função mitocondrial nos astrócitos e, consequentemente, nos neurônios por conta dessa resistência à insulina. Então, talvez o melhor seria melhorar o suporte energético entre essas células, melhorando as questões de aporte de glicose e de sinalização da insulina. Eu acho que também o que talvez ele está pensando é medicamentos que ativem, talvez, a função mitocondrial em tecidos periféricos, como o tecido adiposo marrom, né, que seria um termogênico. Talvez isso, perifericamente, pode melhorar o metabolismo sistêmico e aí melhorar a resistência à insulina cerebral. Mas aí também é uma intervenção.
Talvez, eu não sei. Uma coisa que... Sim.
Não, pode falar. Desculpa,
eu ia só dizer uma coisa, porque, Andresa, tu tocaste aí numa questão que era recuperar a função da insulina. Provavelmente nós não somos capazes de recuperar essa função, porque nós sabemos que os animais que nós temos, eles são hiperinsulinémicos e, portanto, estariam a sobreestimular os receptores de insulina no cérebro. E isso não... Portanto, não seria... Não sei se nós conseguiremos estimular ainda mais e ter uma eficiência. Se calhar são outras... a ativação de outras vias, sei lá, que interagem com a insulina é que seriam de utilidade, não a insulina per se. Eu estou a pensar, por exemplo, há artigos que mostram que endocannabinoide, o receptor CB1, interage com o receptor de insulina. É, se calhar a utilização do CB1 para modular a sinalização da insulina seria uma coisa melhor do que a insulina per se. Eu digo esse, mas sei lá, outro, leptina, por exemplo, também interage bastante com a insulina.
Bom, tem uma pergunta aqui da Paula Belosi, mas antes de fazer a pergunta, deixa eu fazer uma menção muito importante. Hoje no Brasil, gente, não sei se vocês sabem, mas é o Dia Nacional da Ciência e da Pesquisa e dos Pesquisadores, né? Então, assim, nada melhor do que comemorar esse dia com a palestra brilhante do professor João, né? E aí eu queria dizer isso todos para vocês. Bom, a Paula Belosi, que é uma de nossas alunas, faz a seguinte pergunta: Could taurine increase the Western diet model be related to a compensatory mechanism, since some studies have previously related taurine with improvement in learning and memory?
Yes, I completely agree. We have now, I was just saying at the end of, in the end of my last slide, that we are now conducting a study where we are giving taurine to the animals to further increase taurine levels and see if we can improve memory performance in the high fat exposed animals. We also have a study with the Goto Kakizaki rat that we treated we gave them caffeine and measured these metabolic profiles and so on. Caffeine was beneficial. There were a number of beneficial effects in the brain. And we also saw that taurine levels increase further when we gave caffeine. Mm. So indeed, it could be a compensatory
chocolate. Because chocolate and coffee, it's perfect. So.
In line with this, another student talking this sentence. I was just writing about the taurina in Red Bull. Is there any evidence that the taurina containing in the energy drink Red Bull can have some influence in astrocytes?
So you must give the mice Red Bull and
Red
see
Bull,
this.
Yes, yes, Red Bull should be good.
Yes, yes, yes. They will be very, very active.
Caffeine is a stimulant. Taurine modulates GABAergic neurotransmission. It may have a lot of beneficial effects, so it could be good. The problem, and it's the same problem we had with caffeine. When we do a study, caffeine has an effect in the brain that we saw it's beneficial. However, if you actually study the effect of these molecules in other organs, it's not so good. And you think, for example, of the heart. Most of the patients that are obese or have diabetes, they have cardiovascular problems. Coffee is not good for them. It will just exacerbate the cardiovascular problems that they have. So it's kind of a balance. You cannot say that you can treat memory performance in obesity or diabetes with taurine or with caffeine. You cannot say that because you have adverse effects that are much or probably as bad as those that are, or as bad as the beneficial effects in the brain. So Yeah, I wouldn't recommend anything about that. But I agree that, we also when I started looking about taurine, I also found a clinical trial in China that is that was registered in the that is about giving taurine for memory performance in diabetes. Actually, I've seen that. And if you search, you find papers on all kinds of diseases that for which taurine is good. So, I think it's good, but maybe not a lot.
There is another question about medicines and possible treatment. Do you know if metformin can be used to restore hippocampal metabolic? It's a question from a student of ours, Eloisa Antoniella. Do you think it's possible?
So. I think so. I think people have used that. I'm not sure if it's very conclusive. And there's probably also in those insulin sensitizers that are used in clinical trials, maybe there's also metformin in some of them. I don't know. It was shown to be good in some studies, but they are very sporadic in animal models again. So I don't know if it's efficient or not.
Okay.
Don't really know the mechanism. It should be clear that the mechanism of metformin. There was a recent paper from Keiko Sakamoto, I think, on the mechanism of metformin. But I think it's not fully understood what are how it acts.
But it's fully used as a treatment for diabetes. Yes, it works. Yes. It's like chloroquine. No, it's not like chloroquine. Okay, so before I pass to Andressa, pessoal, se eu não falar isso, acho que eu vou ser assassinada pelo meu time aqui de backup. Por favor, ajudem a gente a subsistir. Isso significa que a gente precisa de like, preciso que vocês toquem um sininho aí para avisar as notificações e, obviamente, subscrevam o canal. Então, por gentileza, quem não fez isso ainda, faça isso, né? Até para ajudar, mesmo que vocês não tenham gostado. Tô brincando, não é impossível não gostar, tá, Jô? Tô brincando. Andressa, você quer fazer a próxima?
Andressa.
Tá sem som.
Outra pergunta que já foi um pouco abordada aqui, mas talvez valha reforçar, João, que é o caso da resistência à insulina. How insulin resistance work in the process of memory impairment? Which metabolic pathways is most involved?
So I can only say about the work that we have done, and that was the glycogen. So this is an extrapolation from the data we have with the data that is available from work in cells and things like that. But we think it's the control of glycogen metabolism in astrocytes. It was shown that insulin controls glycogen in cultured astrocytes. The other thing is at the synaptic level, these GLUT4 transporters that are required to take in glucose when you stimulate synapses. So this is probably mediated by insulin, and that will be also a necessary mechanism. Finally, we think from the data we are getting, we think that insulin is also controlling mitochondria in the brain, in the hippocampus. The experiments that we do, they come from tissue homogenates, so we cannot really distinguish the two cell types, the neurons and the astrocytes. But we see that there's insulin resistance is affecting the mitochondria a lot. These are the two things, glycogen, mitochondria, and the synapse, the GLUT4 in the synapse.
Okay, uma pergunta da nossa colega e colaboradora, Kelly Grace. Kelly Grace, oh, foi?
Not Grace Kelly.
Not Grace Kelly, Kelly Grace. João, great talk, ela falou aqui.
Obrigado.
Insulin resistance induces astrogliosis be related to brain inflammation modulation and some brain tumor susceptibility?
So the tumor susceptibility, I don't know. But can you ask again, sorry, related to inflammation, okay. Inflammation, yes. Inflammation,
the brain inflammation.
So the tumor, I have no idea. Tumors are complex. So, but yes, so one thing that we expect to see is that there's neuroinflammation in insulin resistance. Personally, in my lab, no one was able to show that in any model. Maybe we don't know how to see those, how to do those experiments. We have seen, for example, in this, we just have data last week. We measured a panel of cytokines in these high fat, high sucrose fed mice. And we measured, unfortunately, we only measured at the end of the study. So after 6 months, so we don't know if at this stage there's inflammation or not. What we see is a reduction in a few anti-inflammatory cytokines, but we did not see an increase in pro-inflammatory cytokines. We have not analyzed early time points because that's the key in these models, that when you expose, it was shown in several studies, for example, in the hypothalamus, 1 day of high-fat diet induces hypothalamic inflammation. So you have this neuroinflammation in the hypothalamus that shoots up in the first couple of days and somehow dampens afterwards. And when it starts coming down, then you have the astrogliosis coming up. So it could be that in the hippocampus is the same happening. And I'm sure that Andresa can answer that much better than me, that you have inflammation coming up early when you expose these diets, and then later it may disappear, because we have not seen that at the later stages.
E provavelmente, eu acho que também você está... Ixi, estou igual a mulher da CNN agora, gente, aqui. A ativação da microglia provavelmente faz parte desse processo todo aqui e merece ser avaliado. Eu fico pensando também isso no contexto metabólico celular, que essa geração, esse incremento da atividade da microglia, ou essa superativação da microglia, que provavelmente que já foi demonstrado em outros trabalhos, pode ter um papel no comprometimento da bioenergética celular entre astrócito e neurônio também.
Mas só para eu acho, mas isto é uma opinião que eu tenho face dos dados que nós temos no nosso laboratório. Provavelmente isto tem uma transiência, que há um aumento, há uma neuroinflamação que é imediata quando se expõe a estas dietas, e que no longo termo isto deve desaparecer, porque nós não vemos isso depois de 6 meses exposto a dietas. E nós fizemos ainda temos mais umas imunos para fazermos, temos imunofluorescência, real-time PCR, levels of IBA1 by Western blot. We have looked at many things. The only thing we saw was a reduction in anti-inflammatory cytokines.
Hi, I think, oh, okay. João, tem uma última pergunta, a gente está caminhando para o fim, aqui está quase meio-dia, hora do almoço, está todo mundo com fome já, né? Então, tem uma pergunta aqui do nosso coordenador do curso da patologia molecular, um curso que eu e a Andresa somos orientadoras, né, do curso de pós-graduação, e ele fala assim, ó, eu estou pensando que para balançar a falta de glicose, deve ter mais corpos cetônicos, chegando pelo sangue até o cérebro. E se isso acontece, o que se espera em termos de consequência?
Os corpos cetônicos são muito bons para o cérebro.
Bons? Mas,
são muito bons. eu vou mudar para inglês. The neurons, they actually take the ketone bodies just like they take glucose. So if it's available, they will just eat. The neurons, they eat anything. Whatever is available, they will take. Although they rely mostly on glucose, but if you have a reduction in the glucose that you can use, you will take ketone bodies. We have not measured, I think, no, we did measure some years ago, but I think in the Gotokakizaki rats, it wasn't changed. I think, I'm not sure if we published that. The ketone bodies in circulation were not changed in the Gotokakizaki rats. In the other models, I don't know, we didn't measure. But My guess is that when you have a ketogenic diet, it's beneficial for the brain. People have used that against many disorders. And when you're exposed to a high-fat diet, you may as well have those beneficial effects. Something I didn't say that is important, the fat that we are giving is saturated fat. So it's lard-based, it's a lard-based diet, which is never good. So yeah, that could not be good. But I don't think the ketone bodies will be an important factor here. Also because we don't see, even though we see a small reduction in the total maximum transport rate of glucose into the brain, glucose levels are higher in the diabetic animals. So they will have more access to the glucose, which is not necessarily good, depends on the levels, how high the levels are. So I don't think, even though there's reduced rates, the availability of glucose is not limiting, I would say.
Ok. Andressa, você quer agradecer mais uma vez ao João por essa brilhante palestra? O chat ficou super ativo todo o tempo. O nosso chat interno, de repente, estava discutindo também ao longo, né? Eu acho que foi uma coisa muito legal, né? E daí eu queria que você, se possível, agradecesse e encerrasse a nossa live de hoje, né?
Eu acho que foi bombom mais que sertanejo aqui.
Viu? Isso. Será que ele sabe o que é isso? Sabe o que é isso, João? Ah, sertanejo? Sertanejo é um tipo de música country brasileira, certo? Sim. Então, agora com a pandemia, como eles não estão fazendo shows, eles fazem live. Né? Okay. E vão para o YouTube, certo? E aí tem, as pessoas ficam assistindo e tal. Particularmente no nosso grupo, esse grupo mesmo que você está participando, Andressa, o pessoal gosta mais do Fábio Júnior, coisas desse tipo, mas tudo bem.
É mais decadente. Muito bom. Foi muito legal, João. O mais legal de tudo é saber que a gente está perto e não está, né? Pode trabalhar junto e não pode neste momento. Mas nós temos, né, acho que foi legal essa interação, foi legal as questões de bioquímica abordadas aqui, né? E às vezes os alunos me perguntam, para que eu preciso saber, né, da via glicolítica ou dessa mitocôndria? Então a gente está vendo, né, todas as quando ocorre uma deficiência nessas atividades metabólicas, quantas consequências patológicas isso pode desencadear, né? E a gente ainda tem mais um montão de coisas para estudar. Obrigada pela tua disponibilidade. Eu espero encontrar com você as soon as possible.
Using masks.
In Sweden, the people
don't have masks.
Come on. Ah, but you not did well in this pandemic.
It's real. Muito obrigada, João. Eu acho que a gente abre aqui um grande canal para discussões, para contato dos alunos. Quem não conseguiu resolver suas perguntas agora, pode mandar para mim, eu encaminho para o João, ou para a André, a gente encaminha para o João. E a gente espera que o João também, talvez no próximo semestre ou no início de 2021, a gente também está organizando um curso de pós-graduação, espera consegui-lo fazer via remota, a ideia no PPG Patomol, e estamos já tentando alinhavar essas coisas e também ter a oportunidade dos alunos do pós-graduação poderem estar e participar do laboratório do João aqui na Suécia. Obrigada, então, pela sua disponibilidade, desde sempre, não só hoje, mas com a inserção nesse projeto, nessa ideia.
E eu queria agradecer a nossa audiência também, né, que ficou firme e forte, mais de 100 pessoas te ouvindo durante esse tempo todo, né, e fazendo muitas perguntas. Então, acho que foi muito legal em todos os sentidos, né? Obrigada mais uma vez, tá bom?
Obrigado pelo convite, foi um prazer.
Até mais. Acho que a gente...